why I am speaking about Carlo Fontana. As a matter of fact, I am not working at all on Fontana, but I am puzzled by drawings and floor plans for the Salle des Machines in France that I don't really understand. As this drawing, as instance, and also, mainly, these floor plans. More or less known, but never, nobody studied the floor plans of the stage itself. And a few years ago, 2 years ago, I found the floor plan copied by Adal Kranz in Stockholm for the Tordinana. And I was happy because I began to understand this puzzling stage. Ah, okay, this is like this, and this part is like this one, maybe. So I had also problems with the two, with a project by Levaux about a new opera stage, bigger, even bigger and wider than the Salle des Tuileries. And this is why I explained it was located here, never built indeed. Here. And this is why I sent an abstract. I discovered since 3 months how far studying Fontana's drawings is an easy task, because most drawings are not available to consultation everywhere. We have nearly no good photos, except in Vincennes in France, and even among the photos, they missed some drawings in the microfilm, and so on, and so on. Not speaking of the studies, as Professor Tamburini studies or Rotondi, that I can't find in France. So it's really a work in progress. Please apologize. But I show so some points of my methodology and maybe some results. This is why I ask high-definition photographs. This is a part of a drawings by Fontana, Juvara after Fontana in Vincennes. Because I can rebuild very high-definition models in what we call in 4K now. You have a detail. And also in the future, I can work with dancers and after put them inside the restituted stage or even try acoustics experiments in the 3D models. These are simulations, indeed. What you see here are simulations. Professor Tamburini has spoken a lot about Tordinona. This is only a few rectifications about my paper. My handout. What I call Tordinona 3 is the first 18th century, Settecento, Tordinona. So I am speaking immediately about my attempts to model these theaters. I have worked mainly about two models. What I call Tordinona numero 2, concept theater in the Vincennes version, which is not very well known or not known at all, except by Professor Sergio Rotondi. And also, I tried something, but I had not all the drawings, so it's very difficult, about the final version of Tordinona, the really built Tordinona at the end of the 17th century. But it's only a few pictures at the beginning. These are the drawings I found that are known, but very well known, not very well known in Vincennes. And this is the concept theater, what I call the concept theater, maybe the most interesting one because this part is far more interesting than in Stockholm drawing. And I had a very good digital reproduction. And this is a mixed for the likely built Tordinona with Sloan and Vincennes. A first look at my attempt to the final version built. As a matter of fact, I had problems with the height. I have not the accurate size of the building, so it's only an attempt. But it gives us, I think, an idea of the stage. I am interested now by the stage and how it worked more or less fine, even in this blind attempt. And we have also the concept theater number two. I shall go to the 3D model. Where is it? I have to find it. It was opened. Okay. You see, more or less, this is a view of the first attempt for the final concept, not the final concept, the big concept, the huge theater projected by Fontana. And it's very interesting to see that it's closed to future theaters. And it's very interesting also to see that the stage is a huge stage, very wide. This is a personage, a singer. And it was wide opening. And so I have problems with the height that I didn't see on the floor plan. So the 3D model is very interesting to see how far Carlo Fontana was trying to go in designing the theater for the future. And what I can show you quickly, we can discuss around the cafe later. The point of view of the Queen Christina, I have only two, where is it? Yes, the camera is a virtual camera, it's not good at all. And with this kind of software, I can walk, fly, walk everywhere in the model and experiment things. Can be very interesting. Here I fly because it's easy. But we can go also on the in the boxes. In the boxes. Sorry, I have a very little screen, and these software are not made for little screens, but for big screens. But this is what we can see from the boxes. See, and I have a last point of view from the stage, same thing I have to, yes, it's far better. And we can go, you can walk as in video games and test if you can go through the wings and so on, play, dance, everything can be tested. Okay, so this is a very short demonstration. I come back to my paper. Okay. Aviage diaporama. Now, some problems which are very interesting in the version of Stockholm because we have the Didascalia by Adelkranz, likely after Fontana. Meaning information, more or less interesting, but for the stage, very interesting. The most puzzling one is this explanation. I am unable to read. I think it's secondo foro che divide il tragico del satirico here. And I don't understand. Prima cena, seconda cena, yes, maybe, but satirico, tragico, I don't understand. I have asked to several musicologists. Nobody understands. What's this? Indeed, we think about Aristotle, Serlio, and so on, Vitruvius, but I guess that tragico is death part, and satirico, the added backstage for the landscape. Maybe. If you can explain, I should be pleased. Other questions not solved are how wicked were the balconies and galleries, how wicked was the stage. Also, mind difference, there is no pit for the backstage, versus in Vienna, at the same time, Bonaccini built a theater with a pit on the backstage. We know it because they are on the basement left on the cortina in the plan of Vienna during the war. We have the drawing with the pit. So there are differences between Bonaccini, Fontana, and others. Oblique wings were common at the end of the century, alone or combined for the Seconda Cena with right wings. We can make the list more or less long here. And what is interesting is to see that Fontana designed two types of oblique wings. First parallel oblique wings, and in the final version of Teatro Tordinona, unparallel wings. First and after, parallel at the end. Very interesting. This is Pergola, Teatro della Pergola in Firenze. You see the parallel wings, here, 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 and after, the oblique wings, and after, the parallel wings, and the backstage. The second pergola. And this is my attempt for a 3D model. This is the Piccolo Teatro Colonna built by Fontana. It works fine. It's a very, very good theater in the 3D model after the restitution by Elena Tamburini and Sergio Rotondi. The next step is to try to build the accurate Telari. It will be a difficult job, but maybe we can do it. And if you want to understand what are the oblique wings, we find them in Lombard or on this engraving. What is important to think of is that the oblique wings are abandoned nearly everywhere at the end of the 17th century and very early at the court of France, as instance by Levaux, immediately, except they are always used in the Salle des Machines, but I shall explain it later. Francesco Galibi, Vienna, which is quite different from Ferdinando. They are quite, quite different. And I have not rediscovered, but read all the archives about what it did in Nancy. It's quite different. Don't use them. And this is why the Nancy props at the beginning of the 18th century were used later in pergola number 3 with parallel wings. We understand why they could be used. And I found a few days ago on a microfilm what is likely the floor plan in the Salle des Machines for the Régence. I think it's unknown. And as a matter of fact, it's not a big stage and they are parallel, except this, which is maybe a remind of the old stage with oblique wings, reused. Maybe, I don't know. And when we see the Tordinana number 3, Professor Sergio Rotondi will be able to check my interpretation. In this drawing, very, very accurate, we have everything, every feet, everything. We see that it's a normalized stage. Everything has been destroyed inside the building. Levaux, yes, Levaux built or tried to build, they were never finished, but tried to build a little Salle des Comédies in a spirit that is, I think, it's very close to Bernini. When you compare the Salle des Machines and the Salle des Comédies in the Louvre, you see the difference. You see the difference immediately. A wide or square stage, and this is only for decoration. for the prospective. Players, dancers are here. Elena Tamburini has spoken about Bernini. Indeed, it's interesting to know that Bernini doesn't speak about the project or the building built by Levaux, which is closed. They are meeting in the building. He doesn't speak of it. You have seen several times the Salle des Machines, but the empty stage. You have to think that you have seen the empty stage. It's a huge empty building. And he tried to correct its known, and as a matter of fact, we had three manuscripts. Pozzo is working in the same direction as Carlo Fontana, and what we know of him very close, we are not surprised that with the 3D model, it's perfect. It's really a perfect theater. We don't have time to use the 3D model, but what we see that it's really a perfect theater, little theater. Some questions are left. As for the orchestra, in many drawings by Fontana, the orchestra is not wide at all. It's long, but not wide. So I think that maybe, as in the last Ordinona, this was the disposition of the instruments. And for me, it's very interesting because the sound and the way of dealing with the score is not the same. Yes, I know. Conclusions. So, conclusions. The Salle des Machines. I think that, as a matter of fact, the first stage, they use only for the decoration the half of the stage. This one not so deep, 18 meters. After, we don't know exactly how they dealt with the last part of the stage. Maybe they needed room for parts of the machinery, for the king, for the court, and so on. It's difficult to explain, but I think this was the problem. But for Psyché, because I think it's for Psyché, the stage is quite different. It was made by Vigarani. He reused the first part of the machinery here, and after added several things. I don't understand the blue part. If you can help me, I will be very, very happy. Well, there are explanations by Carlo Vigarani about the first stage. It's not very clear. I conclude about the second point, which is very interesting to study also, is the circulation of the designers and the models. Carlo Vigarani and who? Levaux, Roman stage? Maybe, maybe not. Fontana and Juvara, indeed. Fontana aussi, to France, because Dalibert and Latelier were asking in a hurry the engravings to Fontana of the new Tordinona to send them to France, because it was the most perfect theater built. Very interesting to know. And finally, before the last word, I think that the two projects, Vincent Stockholm and the final built Tordinona, are a turning point in the history of theater, well, for the building itself, because the amphitheater is really a theater for the nearly the 19th century. And also, Fontana is putting an end to a technology which is nearly obsolete. It's promised to a future, but the future is at the end of the 19th century or the 20th century, a very complex polyvalent stage where you can do many things with doors and prospectiva. But the stage finally designed by Carlo Fontana was inappropriate for the repertory of the Settecento. Too complex. So the Enlightenment will normalize a centralized and unified stage machinery, and this was the first thing they did when they reopened or transformed Tordinona in the 18th century. So to conclude and come back to the first paper, there were at least three concepts of stage conflicting. Bernini, indeed. Deep stages for royal dances, first Salle des Machines. And also deep stages with numerous wings for operas.
Perfetto.
And I was finishing by, as a matter of fact, it's Bernini who won.
Allora, grazie a Dominique Lavernier per questo bel intervento in cui noi abbiamo potuto apprezzare queste bellissime ricostruzioni. Così che io, per esempio, mi sono emozionata a vedere anche come funziona lì il Teatro Colonna. Io che l'ho pensato, ho immaginato tante volte andare, sembra di poter girare dentro questi teatri, davvero. E, direi che possiamo cominciare il dibattito, spero che ci siano domande.
Professor Lavernier, I'm going to ask you a question in English then, or actually offer something. The difference between the tragic and satiric is possibly a difference between an architectonic scenography and a landscape.
And?
Nature. According to Serlio's treatise of three different stage types, the comic, mm-hmm. the tragic, and the satiric, and the satiric is essentially a landscape. So it may be that the back was nature and the foreground mm-hmm. was architectural. But the other thing mm-hmm. relates to that, and it's in a way the inverse. The Salle des Machines, possible the rear stage was in fact three-dimensional architecture, whereas the foreground was two-dimensional. It was illusionistic mm-hmm. in that sense. And so there's a difference between mm-hmm. 3D and 2D, between architectonic and natural.
As a matter of fact, we find the same things in paintings, remains, in Český Krumlov on the walls and Sabionetta. There are paintings of landscapes, mm-hmm. permanent paintings on landscapes, Sabionetta. Mm-hmm. They are not very well studied. And also, the same things, it's not known at all in Český Krumlov. Mm-hmm. So maybe this is why I think that Tragico is the first part also. But
posso aggiungere una cosa, perché cioè esiste anche appunto il comico, e allora le scene del Serlio, commedia, tragedia e dramma satiresco che ha citato il professore che ha appena parlato, e io direi che siccome so che la commedia, si sa che la commedia aveva una scena molto semplice, capisce? Molto semplice, potrebbe essere la primissima parte, quella più a metà, quella segnata con la linea tratteggiata, la scena della tragedia, e pensando alla seconda parte del palco, di cui tra l'altro si parla anche in questa fonte che ho trovato dell'Ualdi, si parla di due palchi del Bernini, e ricostruendo anche, confrontando con quella degli architetti lombardi, si parla appunto anche lì di due palchi, di cui una parte era il palco tagliato, quello di legno, dietro nelle scene, intanto che si svolgevano le scene cosiddette corte, si preparava manualmente infilando per esempio gli alberi del bosco dietro la scena, quindi potrebbe essere appunto una tripartizione non come quella del Serlio, ma proprio lungo la distribuita in senso longitudinale lungo il palco, considerando un palco tagliato che accoglieva i primi due generi e dietro il palco, nelle scene lunghe, queste scene boscherecce più disordinate, più appunto in questa maniera. Io non credo che sia da chiedere ai musicologi, credo che forse...
Yes, and most time we have the same time, we have the same kind of separations in 17th and 18th century between for the sea landscape and the sea intermediate. We have the first part, which is the city, harbor, port de mer, and at the end, or the desert, the rocks. And at the end, on the second part, you have the seaside, the sea, the monsters, the gods, and all the machinery. And it asks for a quite different kind of stage, at least up to the middle of the 18th century.